Good morning. Come on, let's try it again. Good morning. Hey, if you're out there in the lobby, come on in. We're going to get started. We don't want to just miss any of this awesome time with the Lord in worship. So this area up front here where people are crowding already is called the River. If you're visiting with us, we just want to invite you forward. It's a great place to come and worship and encounter God. We have chairs that are designated as healing chairs on either side of the sanctuary. They're kind of white in color. So if you need healing in your body, just grab a seat, and during worship, our healing teams will minister to you. If it's too loud, if you don't like it loud, we have earplugs in the back and the blue dispenser in front of the sound booth, so help yourself to those. And so I think I went through our whole list of things. We do have worship protocols in our bulletin if you're curious about that. And we do encourage freedom, and we just encourage you to enter into a place with the Lord that you've never went. How many would like to go to a place with the Lord this morning you've never went? Let's all stand to our feet if you're able. I'm just curious, does anybody love Jesus? Yeah. Come on, we should have blew the roof off with that. Does anybody love Jesus? Yeah. I tell you what, let's just put that on display for him this morning. Jesus, we love you. Words can't even explain, Jesus, how much we love you. Holy Spirit, we just invite you to come this morning, inhabit our praises, fill this place with your glory. God, I pray that our worship this morning is irresistible to you. Come on, begin to just do some irresistible worship for the Father. It's okay to make a little bit of noise right now. Just begin to worship. Just begin to worship him in spirit and in truth. Just begin to cry out to him. Just begin to communicate however it is you communicate with the Lord. Just this place of thanksgiving. Just begin to release the thankful heart that you have for him. God, we're so thankful. God, I pray that you just encounter your kids all across this room this morning. As we worship this morning, just take a step out of your comfort zones. Sometime you have to do something a little bit different to have a result that's different than you've had in the past. So if you want to go to a deeper place with him, it isn't always about a physical demonstration or doing something just right. It's really just a matter of the heart. It's really just a matter of, I just want to offer something up to you, God. And a great place to start is, well, I'm only comfortable like this. Just take a step a little bit past that comfort level this morning, and he'll meet you there in a big way.
You paid will forever be enough, and the life you gave. something out.
Thank you.
is like rain. He is like fire. He is like oil. He is like wind. He is like rain. He is like fire. He is like oil. He is like wind. He is like rain. He is like fire. He is like oil.
Thank you. We're just not singing, but we have a heart connection with those words. So much healing comes. So much healing comes. Yeah, thank you, Lord. We've seen so many healings this weekend. We've seen a lot of physical healings in the last couple days. It's just been incredible. The Lord is so good. Is so good to us. And part of that song, it said about giving our past to Him. And that's so important because so many times the physical and the emotional are connected. And what I feel like what He really wants to do today, what I'm really sensing in the Spirit strongly, is that He's gonna heal some broken hearts today. You know, just those broken hearts. There are many people that have walked in that have had a lot of trauma, a lot of things that have happened in their lives, and they have literally broken hearts. And God is really good. We always say in Sozo, He's really good at His job, but He's so good at just putting those broken hearts back together again. All He needs you to do is to give Him your past, to lay that down. Those aren't just words. He just wants you to say yes. Yes, today, that you don't hold on. You're smashing that rearview mirror today. As Dr. Maloney speaks and as he prays, your broken heart can be totally healed today. You don't have to go to counseling. You don't have to go to Sozo. Your heart can totally be healed today because He's a now God, as we've talked about. He's a now God. He does spirit, soul, and body like this. He can align it all up with heaven with no problem. Because He's your dad, and He loves you, and He wants you whole. He wants you whole. So those of you that have broken hearts, and you know who you are, that you've had all of the trauma and all of the stuff, but you're like, yeah, but I had years of this. You know what? He's a now God. Today's your day that you can be free from a broken heart. You don't have to carry around that stuff any longer. He'll do that for you just because He loves you so much. Not only that, but it was already done on the cross. So it's yours just to say yes. So when you sang that, did you believe that in your heart? That you were going to lay down your past? That you were going to give it to Him today? So that He could come in and do what He wants to do with you. Nobody in this room should leave with a broken heart today. And not only that, if you have physical stuff connected to that, you'll see that your physical stuff's going to get taken care of as well. So be really expectant as to what the Lord wants to do. Because He's saying yes. He just wants you to say yes. So Lord, I thank You right now for just touching everybody in this room. That Lord, that You're just touching everybody in this room. You're clearing out all of the stuff in their brain that holds them back, all of the thoughts that holds them back that says, yeah, but it's not His timing, it's not this, it's not that. I've been through so much pain. Whatever the stumbling block is, Lord, I thank You that You're making a clear pathway today, a clear pathway so that they can receive body, soul, and spirit and be totally healed. Totally healed. Thank You, Lord. You're so good. Are you guys expectant? Are you guys expectant? Yeah. If you're not expecting and you're just coming in here thinking it's another service, another song, another this or another that, and you're not in that receiving mode, you're going to miss it. Be in that receiving mode. Just say, yes, I want it all. I want to walk out of here totally physically healed and emotionally healed. I don't want to walk out with any stuff. He needs us to be able to move forward for His kingdom purposes and fulfill our destiny. He can't have a bunch of sick people laying around. He doesn't want that. So thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. You're so good. Well, those are enough words. So do whatever you need to do. Sing Yahweh again so that they'll get that in their spirit. Do they really mean that they want to leave their past behind and move forward?
Yahweh.
In case you're wondering what Yahweh means, it's the Hebrew name of God. It's a little bit difficult to translate, but God has this idea. I am who I am. And the idea is everything that I am now to you in this very present moment. So we sang about wind. You know, wind in Ezekiel caused dead things to live. Oil represented that healing. Water represented refreshing. Fire represented that refining fire, those things that just needs burned off of our lives. And God says, whoever I am relentlessly, and I am fully in this very moment. And so as we're singing Yahweh, you may even want to just get some of those images in your mind of wind causing those dead things to live. Fire burning those things out of your life that you know aren't from Him. Another word for faith is expectation, Cheryl's bringing out. So if you're expecting nothing, according to your faith, may it be unto you. I'm not trying to be mean. I'm just saying this is how it works. And so as we're singing these things, just get those images, water. Lord, I need a refreshing. And everything that you are to me in this moment. So, Lord, I just yield to that. I give up my right to be depressed and discouraged and to hold on to those things. And I just let your water flow over me right now in the name of Jesus. So as you sing this song, God wants to be for you who He fully is in this present moment.
Oh,
I just had this verse come to my mind. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord. Here's what worry is. Worry is you imagining a future without God. Worry is temporary insanity. Like, what are you thinking? So I'm just going to encourage you guys, let's just lift up our eyes again. Lift up our eyes. God, you are so good. Lord, instead, we're going to imagine a future with you. We're going to imagine a future with you. Any situations you came in here heavy with, just imagine that future with God. Fully present in his fullness in that situation. Imagine Columbus's future with God. Lord, we just break off hopelessness right now. See, any area that you don't have hope, you're believing a lie. You're saying, God, this one's too big for you. So, Lord, I just break off any situations that anyone's walking in here with, any finances that they're facing, just saying, God, I don't know how I'm going to do it. I just encourage you right now, lift up your eyes to the God of limitless supply. Lord, we just release the eager willingness of God to provide, the eager willingness of God to come into that situation. I've told you guys this before, like I'm the worst at waiting to give gifts to my kids. I think last year we gave the kids gifts 9 days before Christmas because I couldn't take it anymore. I know it's a bad theology to say God is anxious. God is anxious to invade your life. He can't wait. He can hardly contain himself up there. I would say it takes large amounts of his energy just to hold himself back from invading your life and overwhelming you. He's just waiting for permission. Jesus. I want to take those four images, and you know, this is a house of prayer. I want to take that image of wind. I want you to ask the Lord, what's an area that you want to see dead things come to life? Maybe it's this country's debt. Maybe it's a family situation. But right now, we're going to turn this into a house of prayer. Well, this already is a house of prayer. We're just going to be that. So just begin to pray out loud. Just allow the Lord to bring some things to your mind that he wants to see dead things come back to life in. That picture of water, that picture of refreshing, just put a hand on the person next to you and just release that over them. Let the water of God come. Let the water of God come and refresh and renew. Like a cool drink on a hot day, Lord, let your spirit come upon them. Let them remember your goodness. Remember your goodness.
Lord, that image of fire. Lord, we just pray that dangerous prayer. Fire. God, let us get uncomfortable with the sin that we're comfortable with. Lord, we hear those messages on sin and we think of other people. Lord, let us examine ourselves to see if we be of the true faith. Lord, we want to be that bride without spot or wrinkle. Unfortunately, religion's made holiness a bad word, but holiness is the beauty of God's character displayed in somebody's life. So Lord, let that fire of God bring that beauty of your character into our life. Lord, we pray for that oil of refreshing, that oil of healing, that oil of gladness. Lord, we thank you that you are who you are fully. Jesus. Lord, we pray that oil of healing on our city. Lord, we thank you for a unity that you're bringing to this city. A unity under the glory of God. We thank you for the fire that you're bringing to our city. Where sin just doesn't look good anymore. Doesn't even make sense. Lord, we thank you for the water that you're bringing to our city. Lord, we pray for Sawmill Baptist Church that you would bring a refreshing to them this morning out of nowhere. Or that you would mug them. That you would ambush them there with your goodness. That the wind of your spirit would blow through, that you would refresh Pastor David. It would refresh their leadership. Renew them, Lord. Renew their vision. Increase their finances, God. Let them have finances come out of just unusual places that they'll know the hand of the Lord has moved on them. We bless Sawmill Baptist. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, right now we raise our expectations. We throw off temporary insanity of worry and we just look up and we say, God, wow. Thank you. Thank you for who you are. Thank you, Lord. Well, bless somebody on the way back to your seat. Hugs and high fives are welcome here. Hey, just got, I'm going to invite Josh Lawrence to come up here and give a quick announcement. Don't you guys just love Josh Lawrence? It's hard to even say that name and not smile, I'll tell you what.
Well, some of you know that my wife has been great with child for 9 months. Wednesday morning, we had our baby. So, healthy baby boy, his name's Levi Alexander Lawrence. So,
that's a powerful name. Josh joined the three-boy club. We'd like to welcome him to the three-boy club. That's good. We're going to have our ushers come forward, and as they're coming forward, I want to make you aware that our announcements are in the bulletin, and tonight our Columbus School of Supernatural Ministry, the new quarter starts, So you're welcome to come try it out. Dr. Maloney will be the speaker. And the rest of the quarter is going to be, we're going to have Bobby Connor next month. The topic is going to be how to read the Bible supernaturally. And so I encourage you guys, just stereotypically, charismatics are not strong in the Bible. And so we need to change that. We need to add a depth and a weight to our words and to our life. And so the whole purpose of the Bible is to encounter the author, in case you're wondering. It's not to equip you to debate. All right. So you're like, hold on. That's not what I was taught. All right, well. And the class will probably be 70% you in the Bible hearing from the Holy Spirit. We've had people who are dyslexic who are like, I can't read. God speaks to them through the Bible. It's absolutely awesome. So if you've taken it before, it's new and improved. So All right, so this is the offering for Zion. We'll be taking a separate one for Dr. Maloney. And so we just thank you guys for your faithfulness in giving and helping us partner to reach this city for Jesus, transform this region, all seven mountains. They're just resting up for you, Dr. Maloney. They're saving their woos for us, so you're welcome for that. Okay. So, so just thank you for your partnership. And as you guys know, we're raising some extra money to increase our media and upgrade the level of excellence. And so there's separate envelopes for that for you Zioneers. And so, Lord, we just thank you for your goodness. Oh, we love you. Well, we thank you for what you're doing in this church. We thank you for what you're doing in families. We thank you for what you're doing in this city. And Lord, we just say we're so thankful we get to be part of it. But we ask for more. You said to pray for rain in the season of rain. And so, Lord, we ask for more revelation, more favor, more insight in how we can join with you. So, Lord, as we give of our money, we also recognize we're giving of ourselves. We're saying, God, we're all in. We are all in for you and your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Awesome. Well, it has been some kind of weekend here. This has been awesome. So how many of you guys have not heard James Maloney yet this weekend? All right. Well, my goodness, you guys are in for a treat. And so, the first time I saw Dr. Maloney was on iBethel.tv, and he told a story on there about a number of birth defects getting healed in a row. I hit pause, went to his website, bought every material on his website, and then watched the rest of the video. Then I began to plot, how am I going to get him to Zion? And so he was speaking up in Valparaiso, Indiana, and his health was not doing well at that time. And so I kept bugging the pastor. They're like, listen, you gotta let me go to lunch. He's like, everyone's asking for lunch. I'm like, I'm not everyone. Like, you have to let me into this lunch. He's like, all right, you can come, but don't ask questions. And just, you know, his strength is coming back. And so I told Mary, I'm like, I'm going to be good. I'm not going to be me. I'm not going to be funny. I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to be me. And as soon as I got there, I couldn't help it. I had to be me. And so I'm making jokes, and Dr. Maloney points across the table, and he said, I want to come to your church. I'm like, that's the whole reason I came here. Thank you. And so God has just blessed us. I feel like every time he comes, our water level rises, just our expectation for just the outrageousness of Jesus, just the outrageousness of what life available in the Spirit is. I see him as like a spy in the land, the two spies, who went and said, hey, this is what's available. This is what's possible. And so he's showing us that. So if you missed yesterday, I figured out he actually moved in all fivefold ministry in one sermon. So apostle, prophet, and then he went pastor and teacher. And then since signs and wonders are the dinner bell of salvation, he had those at the end. And so it was like, we just saw all fivefold in one message. Is that Brandon Mathis? Are you kidding me? Pastor Brandon Mathis from Yeshua Life, just stand up. You cannot love on this guy enough. This guy is awesome. Yes. The man who put the bro in Brandon and put the his in Mathis. Don't even start with me. Let's give a Columbus welcome to our friend and spiritual father of this house, Dr. James Maloney.
Well, oh, sit down. It's embarrassing. You know, I forgot to mention that we do have some books back wherever. Let's just say the foyer. If you have not read Overwhelmed by the Spirit, Empowered to Manifest the Glory of God. Everybody say the glory of God. Throughout the Earth, this is my latest book. Please avail yourself. The first chapter is gripping. How many's read it? Because it talks about when in May of 2012, you can believe this or not, I stand before God and I have to give an account of everything I share with you. So there's a tremendous fear upon my life. I would not embellish, But I did have what's termed biblically a translation or a transportation, spirit, soul, and body, for 3 hours to the Middle East. And spent 3 hours in ministry face-to-face with Jesus. And we ministered close to 1,500 indigenous tribals as well as Russians. And it was a life-transforming experience. And generally, I wouldn't put this in a book, but the Holy Spirit really impressed upon me to share it, even though it would open me up to all kinds of, you know, criticism and critiquing. You can tell it's really bothered me. And, you know, but it was a revelation that Jesus gave me concerning what we're moving into, and it's begun, and what I term the Sons of God generation, which simply means, and I shared this last time I was here, that we are sons and we are emptied. We are just vessels, clay vessels, and we have the distinct privilege of Jesus coming in many appearances through his people before his great and open appearing, his second coming. And the Son of Man will manifest the fullness of his faith, his power, and his glory through the sons of God. That's what Romans 8 is really talking about, in my opinion. And so the Lord gave me a distinctive revelation on that through that particular time with him. It was really great. I mean, it was life transforming. But it's kind of frustrating, because how many of you would love to have those type of miracles? You'll have to just read about it. I mean, they were just very, very unusual, because Jesus was there. And, you know, then you got to come back to America. But it's changing. Hallelujah. I said it's changing, and it's changing because of fellowships of this nature that are pursuing excellence. You know, the one thing I appreciate about the leadership of this church, and I've always made this very clear when I was a professor in Bible colleges, you know, there's all kinds of expressions and variety of ministry to mankind, but I've always strived in my heart, my wife as well, just to I would just like to see the ministry of Jesus when you read in the Gospels reproduced. Just heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead. I mean, you know, amen? And then everything else, you know, can come along and be a blessing to us. Let's just get that restored, you know, and reproduced. And so he gave me one of the keys of the kingdom. And so I'd encourage you to get that. Now, what's kind of strange is the last chapter. I'm getting more responses on the last chapter than the first one, because October of that same year, 2012, my spirit left my body, and I spent 15 minutes in the first level of hell. An angel took me there. And it was one of the most gripping, terrifying experiences of my life. It took 6 weeks to get over it. Night and day, pressing through just the incredible sense of hopelessness for people. And, you know, what a way to end a book, right? But it's, you know, caused many to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus, we believe. And just, you know, it's got a, you know, an amazing revelation about it as well. And just various teachings on how the Holy Spirit really wants to gently love you and caress you and, you know, and be your comforter. But he's also, how do I phrase it in a good way, an aggressive, militant, hallelujah, one that's called alongside to rise up within you and aggressively. You know, on the day of Pentecost, it did not come in as a gentle breeze. It came in as a rushing mighty wind, and so we define that. So that is being overwhelmed by the Spirit. I know you want me to throw it out, and you want a freebie. Sorry. My two sons' books are available now. Now, parents, listen to this. You'll enjoy it as well, but if you've got like a 10-year-old, 12, 13, 14, 15-year-old, and it's difficult for them to read Christian material, my son has written two books that are obviously fiction, but they're fantasy fiction. He's got a real gifting in this. And he has one that he wrote just about 2 years ago called The Elementalist. And what's so wonderful about these books is that underlining, it doesn't speak of Christendom, but it has underlining Christian themisms, you see. And he's got entire classes. Now listen to this. We've gotten emails in Australia, New Zealand, and different places where the teachers are requiring the students to read The Elementalist, and then they are, how do I phrase it, acting out the characters in their classes. It's really fun, you know, to think about that. That's Aussies for you, okay? You know, real, you know, expressionist people. They're just awesome. But The Elementalist, and there's no occultish, demonic, divination, witchcraft, like Harry Potter kind of thing, okay? I just want you to know that. His latest book just came out a couple weeks ago, Blue Time, The Master Song. It's a novel, and it's going to be one of seven. He's already got a publisher. He has already been contacted by a person in Hollywood, a producer, that after the third and fourth book, they would highly consider putting it into a movie. The critics have said, listen to this, it is as great, if not greater, than Harry Potter. Hallelujah. So your children, as well as yourself, if you like, I'm not too much into fantasy fiction. It's like The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, right? You know, C.S. Lewis type of books. Avail yourself to the first volume of Blue. In fact, I'll just give this one away to a kid. Of course, that's all of you, right? Well, okay, I'll tell you what. I'm going to give this to your son, and then I'm going to give, well, don't worry, sweetheart. And then I'm going to give The Elementalist to you, hon, okay? Who wants Overwhelmed by the Spirit? I might as well go for it. Okay, you raised your hand first. Is this a gentleman back here? I don't know. You need a haircut. Hallelujah. No, I'm teasing. John, would you take that back to the guy standing there? And just real quickly, this has a horrible, horrible, horrible cover. And we have talked to this young man. He was one of my students in Bible college when I was the overseer of a school of the supernatural for a few years in England. And he somehow felt compelled that he wanted his, what, 3-year-old or 4-year-old? 10-year-old did that? Oh, my God, my 2-year-old grandson. You know, I think it's called Freedom, Freedom, the New Covenant. Is that what it says? It's a New Testament translation that this dear student of mine spent 31 years. He's almost finished with the Old Testament. And I have studied, you know, over 40-some years and 3 doctorates, and I have to say that this is probably the purest translation I have ever read, okay, aside from the lousy cover, but they think it's cool. But if you'd like a fresh, let me try over here, you'd like a fresh, okay, young man. Just take it to him. I just ask, if I'm giving these books away now, you must read them. You know, I've given books away to Pastor Baker. He's never read them, all right? Okay, now this is the one I just want to quickly speak about. Look, I'm teasing, okay? Don't take me serious. Okay, this one is Aletheia Eleutherahou. Everybody say that 10 times real quickly. It's almost like speaking in tongues. It is the Greek phrase, the truth makes free, or the truth will set you free. John 8:32. I see your hand waving way in the back, but I'm going to give this specifically for an individual that's part of the school everybody's waving, okay? Part of the school. Now, what this is, it's Truth Warriors of the Supernatural. This would be, in my opinion, outstanding and excellent for what you're going to be taught in the next several weeks concerning, you know, how to study the Word of God from the perspective of encountering the Lord, so that in turn that you see God confirm His Word with signs following. Every truth, every revelation, it says that the disciples went everywhere preaching the Word, God confirming the Word with signs following. And it is God's intention that when there's a particular truth that is shared, if it's on healing or deliverance or whatever, that God's intention is that He backs that with a supernatural unction of operation, a now, amen, encounter. And so what this book does is, it's volume 1 of 3, it's establishing the glory of the Godhead. I have simplified, trust me, I have simplified this, not for you, for me, all right? Truth shouldn't be that complicated, okay? And so what I have done is I have researched over years and years, and my wife as well, she worked so hard on this. And what we've done is we've given forth truth. Number one, how do we know that the Word is infallible? How to study the Word of God, that the Word itself confirms the reality that it's divinely inspired, that you don't need any outside expression, really. The Word itself can fully confirm that it's inspired of God, and how to study that out. It's called hermeneutics, and how to read it correctly, and how, and it's always for the purpose of getting a revelation of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and to understand the awesomeness of His names, the awesomeness of the Word that sets us free, how to prepare as you study. And then I gave you simple guidelines. It doesn't matter if you are called into quote-unquote ministry to articulate the Word, or you're just quote-unquote a lay person, how to study the Word so that you can properly present it in testimony or in teaching. It's very, very condensed. It's easy to read. It really is. It's fun. And I have gotten reports that out of all of the books I've written, the vast majority of people love this the best. I don't know why. I think Dancing Hand of God is the best, but I'm biased. Anyway, so anyone that's a student, okay, you raised your hand, come on up here, or John, take this to this lovely lady, and it's signed. So, you know, it'll be worth something in about 50 years when I'm with Jesus. Hey, you know what? We've got a new book coming out. It'll be out in about 1.5 weeks. It's called The Lord in the Fires, Increasing in the Awe of God. And it's about 180 to 200-page book, and it'll be out in about 1.5 weeks, 2 weeks at the most. So if you would like to pre-order one, I will do the best of my ability, I'm sure I'll be able to sign it and send it to you. And you can get some of the first copies, The Lord in the Fires, Increasing in the Awe of God. And out of all the books, to the glory of God, that we've written, I personally feel this is the most unique and timely. And it'll bring you into a greater reverential, proper, corrective fear of the Lord. Hallelujah. That gives wisdom. Amen. And it's pure and it endures forever. And also to be fired up. Yeah, that's deep, right? You're baptized in the Holy Ghost and with fire. And it was interesting when I was a teenager, a young hippie in the Jesus movement, that they would talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit but kind of leave out that fire element. Come on now. And so we talk about what is imparted and released in your life when you're going through a specific testing, and what are correct testings of God, what are not intended of the Lord, correct? And the vast majority of them, we bring them on ourselves, correct? Don't always blame the devil, okay? And some can even be the Lord, okay? But you've got to really, you know, present that in the proper context of New Testament theology. So, the Lord in the fires. I like that title, don't you? Ooh, it's just full of flames, okay? So, you can just, you know, back in the table or wherever the books are, just pre-order, make sure, obviously, we get your name and address, and it's $13.95, and so we'll get that immediately sent to you, so you'll have the first, and you know what you can do, you can just wait, you know, it's all going to be on, you know, the web, and, you know, download, and this and that. You know, I appreciate the new technology today, and downloading on your, you know, Kindle, and this and that, but there's just something about a book. Maybe I'm old school or something, but I like to feel, you know, the book, like the Bible, you know. I mean, there's just, right? I know you see me come with an iPad and because I'm saving time, but man, I mean, this, you know, I like the Bible. I like to feel it, get it dirty, right? Hallelujah. Mark it up. Okay. You know, a few years ago, several, actually, I was teaching at Christ for the Nations, and had a lot of wonderful students that would partake in our classes, and it was kind of embarrassing because I would have this particular subject or class, and, you know, sometimes they were up to 250, 300 in a class, and then that would empty out all of the other professors' classes. They'd have one or two. So it really created a kind of jealousy tension, okay? But that's their issue. But we just had some great classes, and we had some wonderful students. And one of those students, he and his wife, were there in the late 90s, and the Lord just, you know, they're awesome students. They're all great. And then there are just those individuals that you can just see that they're just pressing and just the hand of God is upon them. And that, you know, they're going to move in kingdom authority. And so this dear brother and his wife, God has not only used them in youth ministry, but also has used them in the healing operations of the Spirit, but also in business and entrepreneurial expressions. And so they're greatly gifted in that specific realm as well. They're taking certain mountains. Can I say that? Amen. And his wife's in the medical field, so she's got her influence in that mountain. Hallelujah. And he's into just making money. He's got that mountain. Hallelujah. So, but I want Brandon Collins to come on up and just say hi and greet you and share for just a few minutes, okay? Why don't you just welcome him? Amen.
Well, good morning. Like you said, for most of you who don't know who I am, my name's Brandon Collins. So I met Dr. Maloney when I was a student at Christ for the Nations, and as you can imagine, he's 6 foot whatever and scary. And so, but I knew something. I was scared to death of the guy because he's a prophet. And so if you get near a prophet, you know, you're like, what is he seeing on me? But, you know, my life, I grew up around the church. And so I was very good at, while I was in church, looking the part. But away from church, you know, I was, you know, of the world. And so my mom and dad, you know, they're great people. They love the Lord. Went to Rhema, you know, so I learned Word of Faith. Loved Kenneth Hagin. So I was around all that, and I heard stories. And so throughout my life, you know, I lived kind of, like I said, 1 foot in the world, 1 foot in the church. And my senior year, you know, I was the quarterback of our high school football team. And so during that time, you know, God started speaking to me about next steps, and it was really through my mom. You know, she laid out all these colleges to look at, and she was praying for me. And I was looking at, like, Miami, West Virginia, Penn State. Sorry about that. You guys beat us last night. But that's where I grew up, was in Pennsylvania. And so I wanted to play football. And she threw this magazine. It was Sports Illustrated. And Coach Sam Rattigliano, for those of you who remember the Cleveland Browns, he was the head coach of Liberty at the time. And so that kind of piqued my interest. The Steelers actually drafted Eric Green, who played for the Steelers, was 6 foot six, I think, 290 pounds playing tight end. And that caught my attention, and I was like, Liberty. Because I was like, I don't know if I want to go there. But God orchestrated it through those 5 years. I took college. I took it in usually four. I stretched it into five. But, you know, through that time, God really started working and speaking in my life. That's where I got Spirit-filled at a Baptist college. And God just started putting a hunger, desire, and I took my class there was sport management, and so, because I love sports. And I think it was my senior year, I had to do an internship. And Coach Sam said, I will write letters for you so you can get, you know, with these, like the Miami Dolphins, you know, try to get an internship. Nothing happened. And my mom, it always seems like mom has the answer. She said, well, there's a camp down there. You can do your sport internship there. And so I traveled down to Lake Lure, which is North Carolina, and was at a camp. And I was a sport, you know, helped assist you with the sports at the camp. But I was also a counselor. And God always sets you up, right? He always puts you in places to where it's got to stretch you. And so because I was looked at as, you know, the older person there, because a lot of them were still in high school and I was in college, there was a young man, they brought two young men. One had like brain damage. And the other kid was Down syndrome, and they put him in my cabin. And I was like, oh, God, I don't know what to do with this. You know, how do I take care of these kids? And through that week, God really just, you know, I loved those guys. They were so funny, you know, hanging out. They just love you. And how can you not love someone back that's just full of love? So also during that time, it was an Assemblies of God camp, I started reading Smith Wigglesworth books. That'll mess you up. And I started seeing that this man was just he worked. He started out working. He was a plumber. And then God started using him, and using him mightily. And, you know, towards the end of his year, he was in full-time ministry. And so one thing he said that stuck out to me was, he said, first, there was a scripture that talks about first the blade, then the ear, then the ear and the blade or something like that. But it was about a progression of God and how he moves upon you and it steps. You know, you're never going to skip a step with God. So, you know, through all that, I met my wife. And, let me take a step back. What happened was when I was at that camp, God really changed my heart. And then when I went back to school for my last year, I had a chance to go down on the Washington Redskins sideline. The gentleman that was the assistant manager was the equipment manager. So I was able to go down on the field. And if you guys know Heath Schuler, played for Tennessee. He was a quarterback at the time. So I'm standing probably as close to Dr. Maloney, to North Turner, Heath Schuler. And it was a God moment. The pit of your stomach, you're just sick. And I knew this wasn't the road I was supposed to go. And so I was like, oh, come on, God. Not again. There's always detours, right? You think you're going down the right road, and then it's like, nope, recalibrate. Get out GPS. And I just felt empty. And so I had in the back of my wallet a prophecy that, and Dr. Maloney knows Christina for, she's been instrumental in my life, and she would always encourage me. She's like, Brandon, I just see the hand of God on your life. God's going to use you. God's going to do something. And, you know, I was like, whatever. I'm nobody. And so through that time, that prophecy was in the back of my book, or back of my wallet. I kept it, and it was about my future wife. And through a series of events, I met Melissa. 9 months later, we get married. And in 2 weeks, we were at CFNI, Christ for the Nations. Not a good recipe for your first year of marriage. God working on you in your marriage your first year. So my first year, there was a class that was God's General. So God's just building inside of me about the miraculous. And I remember, just to kind of go back, when I would read Smith Wigglesworth and the miracles, I would just, this, I can't explain it, this fire just would burn in me. And I would weep. And just weep. And so, you know, when you're in that place and God's doing a work in you, you can't explain it to somebody. You can't just say, you know, you talk to people about it and they don't listen. And you want to be around people of like faith and people that can stir that fire within each of you. And when I finally got to CFNI, Ruth Heflin, I don't know if you know, she's now gone on. There was a class, God's Generals, and Lynn Dickin was teaching it. And Dr. Maloney wasn't there yet. I think you had spoke that year. And so I didn't really know who he was. So I went to her meetings, and I was like wanting to get a recording because we needed to tape, you know, in the class, somebody that was God's General. So I'm like, why not? Why not her? She's right there. And so I'm in the meeting just minding my own business, and she calls me out and begins this amazing prophecy. And the reason why I'm telling you this is to tell you some funny things. So, you know, miracles and all that stuff. So I go back, and now I'm thinking, all right, that's going to start happening. And one guy came through. If you know CFNI, it's a week of different teachers, you know, and some of them come in and talk about love, some of them talk about inner healing, some of them talk about faith, miracles. And there was this guy on campus, and he had cerebral palsy, you know, and you'd see him walk to class. And so all of us young guys, full fire, right? This guy gets us all excited, and everybody, so we all go around him, we're praying for him, and I get this thought, Jesus said, arise, son, right? So he's going to happen through me. And so I sit there, and I go, arise, son. Nothing happened. And so that was kind of my ministry for about 7 to 8 years. Nothing happening. I mean, nothing. And, you know, God was moving on me and, you know, changing me, but nothing outwardly. And so, you know, I guess what I'm trying to say is you know, when it's time, it's usually when you don't want to do anything. It's not when you're ready and you're on fire. It's usually when you've died to all that. And so when I met Dr. Maloney, and I'll close here, he is what he is. He's just, you know, Dr. Maloney. He's James Maloney. He's, you know, what you see in the pulpit is what he is, you know, behind closed doors. And that's the way we're supposed to be. I'm just Brandon. I'm nobody special. I don't want to be anybody special. I don't want to get up and talk in front of people. But I want to see God move. I want to see, and it doesn't have to be through me. And just over the past 2 years, my son, he broke his arm, and this is where I got connected back with Dr. Maloney, because I got out of ministry. I was just kind of, all right, Lord, if this is true, you're going to bring it about. I'm going to go do where doors are opening, which is I went back into the business field. And God was amazing. He just started opening up doors that I was not qualified for and just teaching me and Melissa and I. But when you have children, you know, I have a young son. He's 17 now. He's quarterbacking at our high school. But he broke his arm, and we were having trouble with him. And this is to encourage some of you parents. You know, God's going to, if you really trust him, he's going to work for you. He's going to be working in your children's lives to get them back to him, because that's what he wants. And my son, we were having trouble. He was talking back to us, you know. He was thinking he was it. He was the quarterback, and everybody was for him. And he broke his arm. And it was in eighth grade. And so, you know, you're kind of hurt, but I had peace about it. I knew, okay, God's doing something. And God really started working on him through this. So he gets his cast off, and he goes to basketball. And the first time he puts his arm down, he breaks it again. Two times. So he's out for 6 months. And then it got to the point to where, Dad, why is God doing this? You know, why is he doing this? And you don't have answers, right? I don't know. Why is he going through this? But now when we look back, he's like, Dad, you know, I'm so glad that happened. He told me that. He said, because God really did something in me. And that's when we met with Dr. Maloney. I called him. I'm like, you know, Caleb broke his arm. And he's like, come here. And he got all his nerves healed that night. It increased his faith. And so now, his last year, he was down on the football field and some kid got hurt. He prayed for him. The kid got healed. He's like, it's Jesus, man. So when you see your kids start to do that and step out, that's really what it's all about, is to reproduce that in this next generation. So thank you, guys. A great pleasure being here.
Doesn't he have a great heart? Do something for me. Just stand and stretch and... high five the person next to you. Just don't miss. All right. After you just stretch. You kind of just need to stretch. All right. Sit down. I'm having fun with you. Oh, it's good to see each and every one of you. Thanks so much for being here. You that are visiting from other cities and communities, we thank God for your sacrifice in this wonderful congregation. And just so much fun to come up here. It's a great time of the year to come up, correct? Now, don't ask me to be here in February, all right? But, you know, maybe tonight I'll have my wife talk for a few moments. No, you don't want to. You know, she can speak. She's an outstanding teacher. In fact, they loved her more, honestly, they did at Christ for the Nations than me. That's all right. It's okay. So anyway, go to Matthew's Gospel chapter 15. Matthew's Gospel chapter 15. I so appreciate John David and Brandon, and it's just, they've got great families. I want you to know that. They've got just awesome families, and they're wonderful fathers and husbands, and I appreciate it, and I'm believing that God's just going to add to our ministry quality men and women to help facilitate the move of the Spirit in the next several years that we're all going to move and enter into, amen, and we're kind of setting that in motion. And believing that the Lord will bless us, number one, financially, so that we can, you know, support this type of endeavor. Because I really do. I believe in team ministry. I've traveled for years, just basically my wife and I. But I've always had, you know, in my spirit, a desire to equip, as our dear brother shared not just this generation, but the next generation. That's always been our motivation. We're educators, my wife and I. So, you know, that's why we're here. And the neat thing about my wife and I, we have this distinct perspective. Let me just say it as I'm opening up here, just sharing for a few moments. Being in this long enough to where when I started pastoring, I had just turned 20, but I had been in ministry and when I was 19, going to home meetings and some churches, et cetera, et cetera. And even prior to that, when I was 17 and 18, I was born again in Spirit-filled in what's been commonly termed the Jesus movement. How many of you ever heard that phrase, the Jesus movement, okay? The hippies of California. And particularly in Southern California, I was one of those hippies that, you know, God arrested my heart at 15, and I was a part of all of that amazing. I mean, you just do a study, just Google it, you know, the Charismatic Renewal, the Jesus movement. It'll give you a wonderful historical perspective of what God did in the late 60s and early 70s. And so when I started ministry, particularly pastoring and then traveling at 23, most of the, you got to understand, back in that day in the late 70s and early 80s, all meetings, church meetings, were in local churches. There wasn't, there was no such thing as a conference on neutral ground, except for maybe Billy Graham or someone, you know, in a stadium. It was all in church settings, church revivals. And there weren't multiple speakers because the vast majority of the churches were smaller. You know, the average Pentecostal charismatic church was about 75 members to 100 members. Okay? A lot's changed in 40-some years. Trust me. Amen. And so in my 20s, the ones that were really interested in the move of God were in their 50s, 60s, and 70s. So I spent a decade ministering to those that were 30 years older. Now, they have, of course, gone on to be with the Lord, the vast majority, if not all. And now their sons and daughters are in their 40s and 50s, okay? So there's that generation that we have ministered to. And now they've had kids that are now teens and, you know, in the early 20s, and they're attending Bethel School to the Supernatural in different places. You see, I mean, there's this generational, transgenerational perspective. So it's like when our dear brother says, well, he ministered for so many years under the radar, you need to understand what that means, because back then you didn't have the internet. You didn't have the communication element of, you know, live streaming and God TV and this and that. I mean, the only way you were known was, I held a revival for 4 days at this church, and there was 100 people, and a lot of people got blessed, so the pastor called his pastor friend 40 miles up the road or 100 miles up the road and said, you need this evangelist. That's how it worked. You just went from church to church, church to church. And so I went literally to hundreds of churches. So in that perspective, I was somewhat known in those circles in that period of time. But then all of a sudden, the next generation emerges. You see what I'm saying? The kids of these people that went on with the Lord. And we begin to see, you know, the transitional change from smaller venue churches, and they became larger in attendance, and then all of a sudden they branched out. Instead of having just one speaker, they'd have two. Now you go to conferences, they're eight, you know, and then it's on neutral ground now. Now, my wife and I, in our old age of, well, she's younger than me, 58, I'm 58, you know, now when I go and minister, I was just about a week and a half ago at Bethel in their major conference. Oh my God, I've got socks that I wear that are older than the students that are attending that school. And they're just awesome kids. You know, they really are. They're just, I just love them. And I just love students. And I just love, and so everybody that comes to my meetings are all students, okay? And so we've got several people here that they may not be here this morning, but they remember Joy and I in our early 30s in Indianapolis when we would regularly go and hold conferences there. And they were like little children. And now they're grown up. They've got their children. And they've been in these meetings. And they remember back 25, 30 years ago. It's an interesting perspective. It really is. And now because of the ability of internet and this and that, you know, what you share and how you minister gets known more rapidly and quickly. And that's a good thing. That God can use that. Amen? I'm not, trust me, a fan of Facebook, Twitter, especially YouTube. Because they'll always get me at an awkward, you know, setting where everybody's looking at my buttocks rather than, you know, I'm bending down or something and everybody in the world, you know, is watching it on YouTube. My God, it's embarrassing. But anyway, you know, it's just what it is. And so, you know, I really don't know what it means to be a big ministry, a big name ministry. I really, the concept is, to me, irrelevant. Did you hear that? Now I'm prophesying. Hear this. Hear the word of the Lord for this church. You know, there's some congregations that are mega. And some of them are dynamic churches. They're not compromising. A lot of them are in their message, but some aren't. And they may be 10 talented type of churches. You and I may be just 5 talented people. But what I'm hearing by the Spirit is this. If you and I that just have the 5 talents, whereas they have the 10 talents, if you're more faithful with your 5 talents, even though you don't have the exposure that they may have, but you're more faithful with your 5 talents than their 10 talents, your reward will be greater than in heaven than theirs. The Bible teaches that. So it doesn't matter, you know. We got to get rid of the striving. If there's anything I'm constantly trying to get across to the students that I've taught over the years, thousands of them, just quit striving for recognition and acceptance. And, you know, I've got to have something bigger and better and more powerful. You know, like our brother said, who cares in whom God uses to bring healing? Just as long as people are getting healed. In fact, what turns me on is you are accomplishing these wonderful things in Christ rather than myself. Amen. I mean, because that's what moms and dads want. How many know? Every mom and dad want your children to go further than you. And what do you think inheritance means? It means that, you know, your children inherit something that they did not have to work for. You did all the groundwork, you laid it, they inherit it, and then take it further. Now they've got to accomplish their purposes. That's what it's all about. Amen. So, you know, I just keep me out of the limelight. Let me just stay under the radar. All I care about, this is all I care about. The person standing in front of me gets healed. That's my whole motivation. Maybe simplistic, but how many know that was the motivation of Jesus? Everybody listen to this. The kingdom of God is at hand. Did Jesus say that? What he meant in that is this. You don't have to look over here, there, yonder, this mountain, this place to worship. The kingdom of God is now at hand. It abides within you. Read Matthew 6. When we pray the Lord's Prayer or the disciples' prayer, thy kingdom come, say it with me, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Yes, of course, we're talking about what's in heavenly realms bring it into this earthly realm. That's a tremendous truth. But really, if you study the Lord's Prayer correctly, it's personalized. It's internalized. It's this earthen vessel, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in this earth. In other words, in my soulish life, remove whatever debris there is. Come on now. Whatever is of the flesh mind, the flesh emotions, and the flesh body, I need to die. Tell the person next to you. Look at them and say, you're dying. Well, not literally, but I mean, you know, spiritually. You're dying, it says in Colossians 3, and your life is to be hid in Christ and in God. All that matters is that he's glorified, he's seen, he's heard, he's expressed. It's not you and I that lives, but Christ that lives within us that accomplishes these things. And you don't have to stretch up or look here or there. It's already abiding within you. So you know what is the great key to advance the kingdom of God in this earth realm? Just minister to the people in front of you. Just influence your neighbors. Influence, you know, your work partners. Just influence the brethren in front of you. That's what Jesus did. And he brought a revolution. Look at Matthew 15. Look at verse 29. And Jesus departed from thence. You can tell I'm in the old King James. And came nigh unto the Sea of Galilee, and went up into a mountain and sat down there. Now stop, look right up here at me. This was in the area of Capernaum. In all of the cities that Jesus ministered in, if you study the scripture, you will find, and it's another message in and of itself, that some of his greatest miracles, if not greatest miracles, I mean, they happened everywhere, but in abundance, happened more in Capernaum region than any other area. In the early part of Jesus' ministry, he didn't have anywhere to lay his head. You know, foxes have holes, birds have nest, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. But later on, the Bible teaches that Jesus had his own house in Capernaum. And I have held a miracle service in Capernaum right next to Peter's mother-in-law's house that they have excavated and brought forth. And there's only 75 or 79 dwellings, real tiny 500-square-foot dwellings that comprise of Capernaum. So when it says there's a great multitude that followed him, you know, you're talking maybe several hundred, thousand or two at the most, which is a lot of people. But, you know, we have the Reinhard Bonnkes that are ministering to 6 million people, 1.5 million at a time. Well, that's mind-boggling, isn't it? Aside from that, you know, you've got downstream in Christian television, millions at one time now are capable of hearing you. I'm making a point in all of this. But yet, the Bible says that Jesus came to Capernaum where he had seen his greatest miracles. And there's a real teaching in that, and I don't have time to get into it, because there are specific regions in North America that I believe are going to become like present-day Capernaums, not present-day Nazareths. I ministered in Nazareth, the Nazareth in the Middle East. It was the most difficult place, one of the most difficult places I ever ministered. The only time where there was approximately right under 2,000 people that half of them got up and spit at me and hissed at me and walked out. Man, I felt horrible. I needed some sozo ministry. Boy, I went back to what they considered was a hotel room, and I said, Jesus, you know, what did I, you know, I was just preaching the kingdom. And it's like the Lord said, now you know how I felt. It's the same demons today as it was back then. They haven't left. Jesus could therefore do no mighty work because of their unbelief. Isn't that amazing that here, You know, he could not operate in the fullness of the Spirit that God had graced him with in Nazareth, but yet he just goes just a few miles over. It's not that far. You got to understand the Middle East is tiny. Israel's tiny. And goes over and sees some of the most astounding miracles. Do you think that Nazareth was the only difficult city that Jesus went to and ministered in? I'm sure he had many Nazareths that he had to go to, but then he also had many Capernaums, but none like the Capernaum. Now that tells me something. Why can't Columbus in this region be one of those Capernaum regions where God does something in a massive, supernatural, awesome way? I mean, listen, the greatest miracles that Jesus ever saw consistently, continuously, was in Capernaum. It's amazing. So it says something interesting, though. Now, here's this uniqueness about this event right here, and this is going to be very quick. And this, to me, is a prophetic ministry picture of the way Jesus heals today. Now, I want you, everyone, individually to take this to heart, but listen to me, corporately, wherever you're from, whatever church, this one, this is your home fellowship, look, take it to heart here. I want you to see the uniqueness of this particular event, and this is why. Because it says that Jesus came into Capernaum, which was right next to the Sea of Galilee, and went up into a mountain. In other words, it's kind of like he separated himself and sat down. Now, his normal pattern of ministry, how many know, was he readily made himself available. He went to villages, didn't he? He went to cities. He went to synagogues, marketplaces, different, you know, areas, out in the fields, and made himself readily available to minister to any and everyone that was sick and afflicted that would come to him. And he would heal them. But in this particular incident, he went up to a high mountain. Could you imagine all of these people that were struggling with their infirmities and crippling conditions and blindness and this and that? That Jesus goes up to this high mountain and it says he sat down. Now, this was a foreshadowing of a present spiritual reality. And this is foreshadowing our day. Hear this. In this, what we term new covenant, correct? We're in the new covenant. Amen? It's been ratified, what? By the blood of Jesus. Better promises, a better covenant than the old. Can I hear a hearty amen? Amen. And this is foreshadowing a spiritual reality. Listen to what Psalm 2 and verse 4 through 6 says. He who sits in the heavens will speak to them in his fury. But as for me, I have installed my king upon Zion, my holy mountain. It's not just talking about King David. King David was a prototype, so to speak, of Jesus, who has been enthroned upon Zion, the holy mountain of Yahweh, Hebrews 12, 22 through 24. And it says in Hebrews 7, I believe, verse 25, that our faithful high priest, is he our high priest, Jesus, today, is in present day ministry. He has passed into the heavens. He is seated at the right hand of God the Father. Not only is he living within you, we'll get back to that in just a minute, but he's also in heaven, and he ever lives to make intercession for you and I. And Hebrews 3:1 says he is the apostle of our profession. Now, you got to understand that we need to have teaching and correct instruction to the people of God, not just concerning, as important as it is, everything evolves around the cross of Jesus. How many know that? The reason why is because that's where Satan was defeated, was at the cross. But how many know there is the message of the resurrection? Amen? But in speaking in terms of Jesus' progression being coordinated, glorified, and set down at the right hand of the majesty on high, you've got to understand He not only was raised from the dead after his death, he was then ascended, his ascension. Then you got to understand, the Psalms brings out that they had a great celebration in heaven. His coronation, his glorification. They went through an amazing celebration in heaven when Jesus ascended back to his Father. And in fact, Psalm 133, it speaks about how the oil fell from the top of Aaron's head down to the very skirts of his garment, covered his beard. It's a type and foreshadowing that when Jesus was glorified in his coronation, that he was anointed as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. And many theologians believe that Jesus literally was anointed in heaven, and that oil flowed from the top of his head in front of all the creation in heaven and came down and touched his feet. And when that oil touched his feet, the coronation lasted 50 days, then the day of Pentecost came. And the Holy Spirit was poured out upon all flesh. Because you are the feet of those that bring good news. Come on now. And the anointing is upon his people. He is a priest on his throne right now. Whoever lives to make intercession for you and I. But you know, if you study this portion of scripture, in the natural viewpoint, it looks like he made himself less available than previously. But it's a foreshadowing of him ascending to the mountain of the Lord and seating himself as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. And do you know that because of that foreshadowing analogy and what Jesus accomplished for us, there's greater access to him now than even back when he walked the earth. Because, you know, the people that God healed could only really get healed. Either, number one, the sovereignty of God would cause an angel to come down, stir the waters. The first sick person that entered into the pool of Siloam was healed. Remember that? Or you just had to find Jesus, who is the anointed one, or one of his disciples, and that he in turn had anointed and sent them out two by two. Basically, that was just the way you were healed. How many know today? It's amazing. This ascension and glorification of Jesus. The Bible says in our text that great multitudes came to him carrying their burdens. I mean, this is a foreshadowing of millions that have come to the Lord over the past 2,000 years in what we term this new covenant dispensation. How many know anyone at any time, anywhere in the world, right now, how many know can call upon the Lord and be saved? Anyone at any time, anywhere in the world, simultaneously, how many know can call upon the Lord and be healed? How many know that's something even greater? So what would seem in the natural to be less accessible, he's more accessible because of his glorification, his ascension and his glorification. And then he has administered the Spirit. He has given us the earnest of our inheritance and all of the Father's blessings with that, that comes with the Holy Spirit's impartation in our lives. And one of those blessings is healing. And that tells me something. And hear this. Over the last 2,000 years since his glorification, he has granted numerous personal appearances. Hallelujah. Amen. And audiences with people that have called upon him for salvation. How many know you are one? Healing, come on. How many know you're that one? Deliverance, how many know? Hallelujah. Answer to prayer, wisdom, whatever you're in need of. His ears open. I'm telling you, he's the apostle of our confession. He's waiting upon us to come boldly. But you know what? We've got to see this through the eye of faith. How would you like to be one of those individuals that had a sick loved one that was crippled? Listen to what it goes on to say as we close. And Jesus departed from thence, came nigh unto the Sea of Galilee, and went up into a mountain and sat down there. And great multitudes came unto him, having with them, see this with the eye of faith, see it today, that were lame, blind, dumb, maimed. Everybody say maimed. That's kalos. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly. It's K-A-L-L-O-S. And the word maimed here means like if you get your hand stuck in a meat grinder, ooh, come on everybody, ooh, and you mangle it, and it's kind of half there and half not there. It's useless, or your leg is cut off, or your fingers are missing, or whatever, maimed. It's not just cut off fingers or feet or whatever, but just you're maimed. It's goes beyond gifts of healings internalized. It's outward maimed individuals. Now, how would you like to be a loved one that your loved one is maimed, crippled, blind, deaf, whatever, and the Bible says right here that, you know, they literally, in the Greek, it means they toiled. They had to persevere. It was tough for them. Why would Jesus do that when previously he, all you had to do is cry out, Son of God, Son of Man, have mercy on us from a distance. He made himself available in every village, town, out in the fields, people's homes, synagogues. But here he's way up in this mountain, and those people really had to persevere. It was difficult for them to drag up their crippled loved ones, blind, toiling up that mountainside. And the Greek brings it out that when they laid them at Jesus' feet, it literally means they threw them down and said, look, I'm done with them. I'm exhausted. There's no more in the natural anything can be done. We're casting this entire burden on you. This has been a burden in our lives. We love them. We love them. We're giving them to you. We throw them down at your feet. I mean, they just dumped them, the responsibility. And do you know what? Jesus, listen to what it says. He healed them. Amen. I mean, he healed them, and they glorified the God of Israel. Now, let me just say this. I know this is a simple word of exhortation, but let me just put this in the context. We're going to pray for this lovely, wonderful local fellowship and anyone else's, you know, pastorate. I love the local church. I love pastors. I've given my life to the local church. You may not know this, but when I was 24 years of age, I went through, how long would you say, honey? It would last about 3 to 5 weeks, and then there would be like a month break or two, then we'd go another 2 to 3 weeks. I went through from 24 years of age to about 27 years of age of continuous, miraculous revival, complete open heavens. I thought I had arrived. And I was at such a young age, you know, I'm getting it in my 20s. We were seeing the maimed healed, blind, deaf people every night, night after night after night, whole open heavens of operations of God. Glory encounters where entire congregations of 1,000 would be slain into the power of the Spirit and out for 20 minutes. Every man, woman, and child, saved, unsaved, all of them, pastors, elders, everybody. All I had to do is wave my hand. And there was no pride or arrogance. I just, you know, wow, Lord, this is, whoo, I don't have to wait until I'm 90 to enter into this. Hallelujah. And we would have whole weeks of this. And then all of a sudden, it was kind of like it was shut off. Well, what did I do? Where's the sin? You know, and then I'd go through a month or two of, you know, self-analyzation and introspection, and then all of a sudden the glory would come again in another region. We had countless in this period of a few years of these type of glory where they would last for weeks. Everywhere we'd go, it would be the same thing. It'd be the same type of operation. Boy, I want to get back into that. Hallelujah. I'm believing that. But, you know, so I had a very famous evangelist. I will not mention his name. Don't ask. Okay, afterwards. That sent two of his administrators from his huge worldwide ministry. And after seeing the demonstration of people walking out of wheelchairs and people that didn't have toes were recreated, come on. Missing thumb healed. I'm not embellishing, stuff like that, you know. I'm 24 years of age. And struggling financially, thank you very much. And because I just would not use what was happening supernaturally as a ploy or tool to manipulate people to give. And there's one thing I can say in 40 some years of ministry, I have never pressured or manipulated verbally or any other way financially like some do. Well, but they got the money. Well, they also, for some of them, got their reward. Because you know what? It's free. Everything's free. Freely you've received, you freely, what? You're to give. That's just my motivation in my heart. So anyway, but they came up, we're struggling, you know, and this and that. I couldn't believe it. All these great miracles, and they put 50 cents in. For some people, that maybe that's all they had. How many know that 50 cents was worth everything? I honored that 50 cents. But I knew that there were multimillionaires sitting there that put 10 bucks in, but they got healed of their leukemia. Okay? Now I've been healed. I'm being healed. No, I'm healed. Hear my last statement. But we're struggling, okay? We're struggling. You know, I've got to, you know, I have a family needs, and two representatives of this huge worldwide ministry came up to me and said, young man, we have never in our lives seen such operations since the 1940s under Jack Cole or different, mentioned different people. And the great evangelist so-and-so, I won't mention his name, has heard about you. And what he wants to do is completely finance your traveling ministry. And what he wants you to do is this, if you'll just, you will not only prosper financially, but he will pay for all travel expenses, advertisement, and put you in neutral settings, auditoriums, where the people will come out to you. Now, how many know what I just said? None of that is wrong if it's in the proper context. Listen. But this is what we and he ask of you, that you give up and quit traveling to local churches and just forget about the pastors. Now, you know what? When they said that, something hit me in the pit of my stomach and soured me, and it just didn't sound right. How could you do that? Because you know what? James Maloney comes and leaves. How many know you're here next Sunday? It's not what happens through this ministry. It's what must happen through this ministry. I've always loved pastors. I've always loved the local church. I've supported them even when they wouldn't correctly support me. and let it go. But you know what? When that gentleman said that and the other person with him, I said, sirs, I can't do it. Are you kidding me? They said, you are giving up. This will not be offered again. I said, I don't want it. Now, how many know in the flesh that was a temptation? I could have been promoted a whole lot more quickly. But when they said, you know what? You give up on the pastors. Don't have any dealings with them in the local church. You just go on neutral ground and operate your gift. It's not just about my gift. It's about this gift to this community. You're a gift to this community. It's what God is establishing corporately. It's what needs to be imparted after we leave. What needs to come into your operation on your day-to-day, amen, walk with God. That you come up higher, that God uses you, that God speaks more clearly through you and to you, amen. That you come into greater freedom, that the kingdom of God becomes a reality in the now, that it's a part of your life. And I just could not do that. Now, I share that with you because I believe in the local church. I believe that everything God wants to do, I'm not minimizing those that are on neutral ground. We do that often. There's conferences. Thank God pastors support those conferences. But you know, this is the reality right here for Columbus, Ohio, and other precious fellowships in this city. I share that with you because in Acts 5 is a quick illustration, you know it, that it says that after the cleansing of a leaven of hypocrisy that Ananias and Sapphira was attempting to get away with, and it would have tainted the pureness of what God was bringing in operation. The Bible says in Acts 5, you can read it, you've read it, great fear came upon everyone. Wouldn't it you? Hello? You know, if I was sitting back, it actually says that the rest did not dare join themselves with that bunch. That's what it says. See, in other words, there was people hiding in the shadows kind of waiting to see if Ananias and Sapphira would get away with their little lie. You remember what the lie was? You know, they said they'd given all of their portion of land, yet they only gave a small portion or one element of it. In other words, you know, I don't know why. You know, they just probably thought that, well, if this Christianity doesn't work out, well, we've got something to fall back on or something. You know, there were people that were hoping that they'd get away with that. But under the discernment of the Holy Spirit, Peter perceived it. And it was a strong judgment or chastening. But it says that great fear came upon everyone. And hear this. It says they were at one accord. It says they came into one accord. Everybody say that with me. One accord. In Solomon's porch, they came into a spirit of unity that was so awesome. Now listen. It wasn't just Jesus coming to Capernaum. And it was just Jesus in Capernaum why these great miracles took place. It was the body of Christ in Capernaum that had an anticipation. It was a corporate anticipation upon the church in Capernaum that Jesus entered into, and entered into that already established flow of anticipation. And it's the same in that season of time with Peter in the Jerusalem area and the surrounding region, that these precious disciples, hear this, corporate body, if you want to see greater miracles, it's not just put upon my shoulders or the leadership of this church. God's looking for congregations that when they come and fellowship on Sunday morning, when they fellowship Saturday night, when they fellowship, if you have cell meetings, if they fellowship, that they when you come with an anticipation, an expectation, a hunger, an excitement, and you do, you have that. And you praise and you worship, and there's such a depth and a richness. It's in that environment that we'll see the maimed healed. We'll see the blind, the deaf. Why? Because Jesus has sat down. It's finished. Everything's been accomplished. 99% of what you're asking for God to do is already yours. It's not wrong to ask, but it's just more really claiming, thank you, it's mine. You finished it. It's done. He's seated. And now you've got a personal audience with him at any moment of time in your life. My. Even in Jesus' day, those people didn't have that. That's why we're going to see the works of Jesus and greater works. Can I hear a hearty amen?
Amen?
It's got to do with this church. It's got to do with your love of the person sitting to your left and to your right, in front of you and behind you. It's got to do with you staying in one accord, harmonizing. Man, just, you know what it says? You know, there's a verse in Ephesians that says, be easygoing. You know what I interpret that as? Give people a break. Well, they've got imperfection. Really? I haven't found the perfect church yet. You'll never find it, because as soon as you join it, it has become imperfect. You know, you know, it's just, we're just human vessels of clay. Hello? And do you think we ever do it correctly, like fully like Jesus? No. I guarantee you, every time I've ever ministered, there'll be some aspect of something that was soulish or not of the Holy Spirit that will be burned in the fire. Hello? It's chaff. It's wheat. And I just pray that there's just more of him, so there's more silver and gold, amen, and less chaff. The problem in the church is there's a whole lot of folks that think they're super anointed, and you know what? They can't even discern that it's chaff and wheat. There was, last illustration, a very famous evangelist, traveling teacher. I will not mention his name. Do not ask. He is so well known, everyone would know who he is if I mentioned his name. 30 years ago, one of my mentors, Dr. Chuck Flynn, a great prophet, when the Assemblies of God churches, the Four Square Pentecostal churches, the Pentecostal Church of God, all the Pentecostal churches, there weren't too many charismatic churches. They just would not, the Word of Faith churches, they just would not, listen to this, open up to personal prophecy. Can you believe that? It's true. I actually had them tell me, another whole group, a denomination, Pentecostal denomination, we'll put you in every major district church all over the world. Because we love the miracles, we just ask that you do one thing. Don't personally prophesy over people. I'm thinking, you know, that's my whole motivation is prophecy. You're like taking my heart out, cutting my heart out. I said, let me ask you a question. I said, when I called out this man and prophesied his destiny, I did not know that that man was given 1 month to live because he was in the advanced stages of leukemia. But because I personally gave a word of prophecy of his future and his destiny, that struck faith within him that, well, if that's God's will for my life, then obviously this cancer isn't going to take me out. So I claimed the word rather than the cancer and instantly got healed. I'm going to believe the prophet and I'm going to prosper. And here's this group. I can do it. I'm all right. Here's this group that wanted me to operate in miracles but don't personally prophesy because it's in the tenets of our faith that we don't believe in that. Oh, give me a break. And one of these famous present-day teachers, I'm closing, present-day teachers, you would know him if I'd mentioned his name, my mentor friend who's gone on to be with the Lord, great prophet, had spent 45 years in ministry being marginalized and minimized because he would not renounce or lessen the importance of personal prophecy or the prophetic. Is this a prophetic church? I believe it is. And this guy was working the table of a more well-known famous, if I was to mention his name, you would know who I'm talking about. And this present-day world-renowned teacher, who is a multi-millionaire, sobbing, came up to Dr. Flynn and said, "What you're operating in, that's my calling." And so Dr. Flynn said, "Then be willing to pay the price." "But you don't understand. Our particular fellowship of churches do not believe in personal prophecy." Now, this is not a Pentecostal denomination. This was Word of Faith. They don't advocate personal prophecy. I just can't. It's too much of a sacrifice. So here, Dr. Flynn, for 40 years of ministry, marginalized, I mean, well known. But if I were to mention this man's name, everybody knows who he is. God blessed Dr. Flynn financially, blessed his family. This guy's worth $250 million, probably. There's nothing wrong being worth $250 million. What I'm trying to say is this man had a chance to enter into his true calling, but said it was too great of a price. So, in my opinion, yes, there's measure of blessing in this man's ministry when he goes and sees Jesus face to face, of course, but not at the degree and level it could have been. Look at me, precious people. Everything we do is not just for this present time, but for all eternity. Amen? How does heaven perceive this church's expression to this community? Do you know the wonderful leadership of this church could tweak things and, you know, change things? And I'm not always saying that's always wrong, you see. There are some things that, you know, are good changes that help cause people that are unsaved to be wooed to the Lord. But when it comes to the basics of what we stand for, how many know? We are a spirit-filled church. This is a charismatic, come on, I want to hear some amens, Pentecostal, tongue-talking, prophetic worshiping, dancing, twirling, skipping, jumping, prophesying, deliverance, sozo church, Word of Faith, renewal, get in the river, all of it. So if you're worried about your reputation, it's already been ruined just by the fact you're here. So forget it. Because all that matters is when the time comes that the multitudes are presented to you that are blind, deaf, lame, crippled, and maimed, that there's a corporate body like was in the city of Jerusalem. It wasn't just Peter. They were all in one accord. It had those miracles happen, that the very shadow of Peter as people passed by were healed. Do you know the reference brings out that in that particular incident in Acts 5, everyone was healed. Not even Jesus saw that in his earthly ministry. Every sick person in Jerusalem and the surrounding area that came were healed. There was not one sick person. Capernaum, it was a corporate anointing. That's why Jesus loved going back to Capernaum time and time again, time and time. You know, I think Jesus said, oh man, these people are getting it. And I guarantee you, it wasn't the Capernaum people that were saying, we want Barabbas. It was a religious Jerusalem people. I'll be a Capernaum. Honor the local church. Honor what you're doing. Move into it. Have a great year in 2015. I was praying this morning, and I said, God, what is it about this church that I like? No. No, I'm asking for revelation because I really love this church. And I said, no, that didn't sound right. Yeah, that was a little sarcastic. No. What is it about this church that I like? You know, that sounds like Jim Baker. No. Just... notice I'm not looking at him. But anyway, I said, what is it about this church that I just really, you know, or what you love about it? I'll tell you what I felt the Lord say. You know, they're delightful to me. You know, Bob says, delight in the Lord and what? He'll give you the... That means that when God comes into your midst, you adapt to what he's expressing. What he wants you to enter into. That's what it means to delight. He'll give you the desires of your heart. You're a delightful group of people. The Lord gets a kick out of you. No, I'm serious. You really are. I'm not saying you're perfect. Turn to the person next to you. Say he's talking about you. Trust me, you're not perfect. But I'm just saying, he gets a kick out of you. Is that okay? That's our modern terminology. You razz him, man. You stir him up. I mean, he just delight. I mean, it's like, I delight in these people. They're a delightful group. They just really just tickle me. You know, they're neat people. That's the anointing, by the way. No, that's him telling me to quit. All right, hallelujah. See yourself when you assemble every time in that light. That I'm coming to this church and anyone else from any other churches, just for you as well. There's great churches in this city. They're all awesome. You know what? You just see yourself. Wow, I'm in a church that God, you know, it's like, you know, God show up. No. Flip it around. It's just like God's already here waiting for you to show up. Hallelujah. He delights in you. Tell the person next to you. Say, you know, he thinks you're a trip. God thinks you're a trip. You. Come here, Pastor. Now look, now come on. Don't tell me God doesn't have a sense of humor. I love this guy. He's kind of like me. We got this funky little feisty, what do we call it?
I don't know.
Whip, a little sense of humor. It's kind of edgy, unreligious. I love unreligious people. I don't know about this Leave It to Beaver outfit, but you know. I don't know about that. But I'll get past it. Hallelujah. It is a little nerdy. Go ahead. Okay, all right. I know Mary did not dress him, okay? But he's awesome, and so are you. And when, when we come back tonight, let's let our hair down. Let's prophesy. Let's get into panorama. Let's just smile. The camera's on us. Give the Lord a praise offer. Hallelujah!
Well, I guess you guys know what my Christmas card's going to look like. What was he trying to rename our church? What was it? Tongue-talking, water-walking, skip-jumping, and devil-balking. What was that? I don't know, man. Shake, rattle, and roll. Man, that was good. A little long, but good. Well, hey, we just want to receive an offering for Dr. Maloney and for Joy and for their ministry, so we can have the ushers come forward. Again, tonight at 5 o'clock, and so eat fast or just fast, and it starts at 5 o'clock tonight in our school ministry, and so you do not have to be registered to come and just try it out for the first one, but there's envelopes in the seats behind you, and you guys can, if you want to give and get credit for it, if you want to... give by a debit card or credit card, that'll work too. So let's give you a second to write. So there was a good number of people who weren't here last night. I'll just go ahead and just let you know the rumor that's going around is that Dr. Maloney and Joy are actually going to move to Columbus. Yeah! So, of course, I'm the one who started the rumor, and they haven't substantiated it. But you know that's how it starts. And so rumor/declaration. Well, hey, we'll just see. And so, ushers, go ahead and receive the offering. Share a testimony. Eddie, did you share that one that you sent me? Well, why don't you come up and share that one that you sent me? Or do you want me to just play the Vox? All right. I don't remember it well enough. Yeah. You had the details.
Got a testimony in. Had a lady who was prayed for Friday night. She had a quadruple bypass, been on oxygen since.
83.
83 years old, was prayed for, completely healed, not on oxygen now. She went from 84 to 96, which is perfectly normal.
That's my mom!
All right. I see that hand. What? Oh, yeah. And so there was a young man, a boy with Down syndromes that came from Michigan. The family drove him down here, and he had never responded before to his name. And so while the father was holding and waiting in line, Dr. Maloney gave a word of knowledge about something about rewiring in the brain. And the phrase that he used was the exact same phrase the doctor had used about what was going on with him, why he couldn't respond. And so the boy woke up the next morning and responded to his name. For the first time ever. It's what I appreciate about is a lot of the stories that, you know, Mary and I get to hear over lunch is that a lot of times there's something imparted, and if you heard him, he encourages the parents, like, stay with that. Stay encouraged. Keep celebrating what God's doing, and lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. And so we love the instantaneous. The vast number of Jesus miracles were instantaneous, but we're going to celebrate however it comes. And so I just encourage you. So they didn't see anything while he was holding the boy. Something was imparted, but the dad kept himself encouraged, and the next morning something happened. And so I just encourage you guys who receive prayer. He did kind of a mass prayer for, it seemed like more people came for prayer than were in the building. I don't know if they like multiplied like the loaves and the fishes, but the but just something was imparted. I encourage you guys, just keep celebrating it. Keep enjoying what the Lord's doing. We stand for closing prayer. Brandon, why don't you come close us out? Brandon knows how to pray. I'm not sure if he knows the hungry man prayer. This is one of the fathers of the city right here. So we love this man.
Before I pray, I want to thank you guys. The other week, you guys received an offering for me. And I had just ministered about asking. And I shared about 11:11, Mark 11:11, that says, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be open. And I was sitting on the couch and I had a need. So I said, Jesus, I asked you for this financial need. And about 15 minutes later, you call. Said, we just received an offering for you. It was the exact amount that I had asked for. So I wanted to share that with you guys. It was an awesome just kiss from the Lord from you guys. And so, Father, I thank you for this ministry. I thank you for this pastor. I thank you for the sensitivity of the Holy Spirit on this church and on what you're doing in this city through Zion Christian Fellowship, Father. And I declare your blessing upon this man of God. I declare your blessing upon this season in Zion. I declare your blessing upon every member that is associated and connected with this ministry. I thank you for a season, Father God, of open doors and open heavens and manifested tangible glory of God to manifest in this house, in this people, Lord God, even as a result of this weekend, Father God, an increase and manifested miracles on this congregation, on this people, on this city, Father. I thank you for an open heaven over Columbus. As a result of this weekend, Father, that miracles, signs, and wonders are the portion of Columbus, Ohio, that it is not now, no longer, maybe you will, but we are Capernaum. We declare that we are the city of Capernaum, and we expect and we anticipate miracles, signs, and wonders as a result of what you have done this weekend and as a result of what you're doing through Zion Christian Fellowship. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Wow. Well, bless you guys. Our ministry teams are coming forward. If you could look around and just pick up the garbage, that would really help us. And bless your children's workers, children's ministry workers. Book tables are out there. Are you guys trying? Do I need to say something? Oh, okay. Yeah, bless your children's workers. Go grab your kids before you get ministry, or maybe just if you're married, one of your spouses could grab the kids. If you like a prayer of agreement for healing, just any area you need, we'd love to bless you. Prophetic word of encouragement, our teams can do that too. So tonight at 5:00, again, if you can pick up the trash, grab your kids. Bless you.